1. That's what we're going to be today. We've been going through the entire Bible. If you've been with us, been tracking along with us, we started in the beginning of the year in Genesis, we'll end the year in Revelation. And we've been going through the entire Bible. And we started this series last week going through the wisdom books, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. So we'll be in this for the next couple weeks. And we're covering books that deserve more than one week. It's not fair to try to cover a book like the Psalms in 30 minutes, all right? But today, we are going to do that. We're going to attempt to do it. It's going to be interesting. We're going to be in this book. We'll start in Psalm 1, and we'll just see how far we get. All right, how many of you guys have journals like this? You keep journals? And like moleskin, anything like that? My wife halfway raised her hand. Anyone? Yeah? No? I have 43 of these. I counted them the other day, right? And that's not to impress you, because they're not full, all right? They all start with like, all right, I'm committing to write in this journal, and then like 3 pages later, that's all it is, right? And then there's a new journal that basically says the same thing. Like, this is what this is going to be in this journal, and then it has like 10 pages, and then the rest of it is just blank. It's like, that's awesome. That's awesome. It's really great. And I have stacks of them, and they're random. So it's like song ideas or devotional thoughts. Some of them are pretty full, and they go all the way back to my college days when I started actually reading the Bible, and it was making sense to me, and I just started to put thoughts on paper, and some of the stuff is pretty profound. Like, I'm reading, like, I wrote that? That's amazing. Like, I should probably share that with someone. And then there's other things I read, like, maybe we should just throw that piece of paper away. And in fact, I about 10 years ago, I shifted everything digitally. I started using Evernote, and I started to try to blog, right? That was before that, actually. I tried to blog, okay? I tried to write thoughts digitally, and then I put it on pause when we started Oakleaf, and then I went back recently, and I was thinking about this, and I was thinking, going through all these journals and composition notebooks. I'm like, I wonder what I wrote on my blog. So I went back, and for 10 years I hadn't written anything, and they deleted the hosting site said, we just thought you were dead. Like, they didn't know what happened. It just is gone. And I was like, how do I get back some of this stuff? I mean, what if I wrote something that was pretty profound? So there's this thing on the internet called the Wayback Machine. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? So I go to the Wayback Machine, and I'm looking up my website from like 12 years ago, 13 years ago, to try to find like some stuff that I wrote. So I found it, and it's all worth deleting. It's none of it's any good. It's just all garbage. I was like, they made a good decision. Anyway, if I took all of these books, if I took all the stuff and I took all the pages that had something written on it, and I put them together, or somebody found them and went through it and kind of tossed out the stuff that was junk and kept the stuff that was really good, you might be able to, you might be able to compile something that you know, might be worth reading, you know, to someone. I don't know. Something that would, it's like, you know, maybe if you write 1,000 pages, you might have, you know, 1 or 2 really good pages. Or like if you write 1,000 songs, you might have 1 good song. So maybe if I took it all and I found all the good stuff, I could put it in something and it'd be kind of nice. Well, that in essence is what the Psalms are. Right, they're writings by a bunch of different people that were compiled and put together with a very specific purpose. They were designed with the readers in mind. It was designed to tell a particular story. And so when you look at the Psalms, you think this is the largest book in the Bible, and the Bible is a collection of books, right? Psalms, one of them. Well, Psalms itself is a collection of books. You've got Psalms written by David. He wrote almost half of them, 73. And then you have Psalms written by Moses. He wrote Psalm 90. And then you've got Asaph, who wrote several, and Solomon wrote a couple. Korah wrote 10. And then there's several, the rest of them, really like 49 of the rest of them. We don't know who wrote them. But there's a span of like 1,000 years, right? If you go all the way back to the one that Moses wrote, to when this was compiled and put together, you've got, you know, the 1450s of Moses, and you've got the 5th century of B.C. of Ezra, and he's probably the one who put all this together and had forethought into what he was selecting and what was being said. And we know that it's intentional because the very back, the very end of Psalms, you have Psalms 146 through 150, and they all start and end with hallelujah, blessed be the Lord. And their endings, their doxologies, that praise the Lord, that praise to Yahweh, that's what hallelujah is. They start and end that way, and they correlate to these different segments in the book of Psalms. Now, this is the most read and most circulated book in the entire Bible, right? This lyrical writings, the poems, prayers, they're filled with pain and with praise and promise, the fulfillment of prophecy, and it gets a lot of peace. There's a lot going on in here. Psalms and Proverbs are the only books in the Bible that attribute authors. That it's a composite of works by multiple authors that tells us who they are. That tells us that there are multiple people who wrote what you're reading. So you take all these writings from all these different people, and you compile them together, and you see that there is a purpose behind it. And in Jewish culture, especially once they had rebuilt the temple and they had reinstituted the law and were beginning to put things back in place the way that God had intended, the Jewish people were beginning to follow the teachings again, it was just as important to read the Psalms as it was to read the Torah. In fact, the five books, the five sections of the book of Psalms correlate with the Torah. And so you could see the first section correlates with Genesis, the second section correlates with Exodus, and so forth and so on. And it's really interesting when you look at the themes, because they have specific points, they have specific themes. All the books and sections close with a similar doxology. In some way, it says, blessed be God forever, or God is everlasting to everlasting. And in some way, it closes with this doxology before it gets into the next section. There are psalms of lament and psalms of praise, which are called hymns. There's psalms of thanksgiving, psalms of pilgrimage, what you would recite and say as you made your way to Jerusalem. There are psalms of wisdom. There are royal psalms, victory psalms, law psalms. There are even psalms that reference specific tunes. Like if you looked at Psalm 45 or 60 or 69 or 80, I think there's a couple more. It says to the tune of lilies. I don't know what lily sounds like, but in my head it's Mary had a little lamb or something. I don't know. Like you read it and try to find there's, but they knew, and so whatever tune they had, that particular psalm was to be recited to that tune. There's another one, Doe of the Morning, Psalm 22. So that's very fascinating. So some of these were definitely songs that were sung. Some of them were prayers that were to be prayed, poems that were to be read, and they weren't randomly arranged. It was very intentional to teach Israel how to worship God, to call back to God's instruction and God's faithfulness, to illuminate his greatness and his covenant promise to his people, and to teach Israel to worship God. So I want us to take a minute. I want to start with Psalm 1. I want to read it. It's an introduction to the whole book, and then I want to break down the different sections, so we know when we come to this book that we can read it, we can understand it, we can see that it calls back, and there's so much here for us to consume. So let's just read Psalm 1 together. Psalm 1 verse 1 says, Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither, and all that he does he prospers. The wicked are not so. They are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. All right? What a great way to start. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, but meditates on the word of God day in and day out. It sets the stage for everything else that is presented in Psalms. But when we read this, you don't have to read it chronologically. I mean, you can jump from place to place because each short verse, now there are some that are longer. Obviously, the longest single chapter in the Bible is in Psalms as well, Psalm 119, which has its own 22 different sections. So it's really, really long, which also harkens back to the Torah and the Hebrew alphabet. So you have a lot of wisdom. You have a lot of forethought. But they've taken the best of the best, the writings from King David, from Solomon, from Moses, to others, they compiled them in here. And we get the benefit of the message that was not only true for Israel then, but also true for us today, that God is to be worshipped. He is to be recognized for who he is and what he's done and what he's promised will come. So it's a beautiful book, and it's really, really great. But I want to talk just real quick about the five different sections so that when you approach the book of Psalms or think about the book of Psalms, you know that there is purpose to it, and it's not just random. So the very first section, which is chapters 1 through 41, the first book, I put it in, I say that this the idea of these first books is God beside us, right? It harkens back to Genesis. But the first book reminds its readers that we are supposed to remain faithful. We're faithful to God's promises, look forward to the Messiah. Now, that was true for them in Jesus' first coming, God coming incarnate in the person of Jesus originally, but that's true for us now and approaching the second coming. And there is that faith that it happened, the resurrection and all, that the death, burial, and resurrection was true, but that his promise to come again and rescue us eternally is true as well. So as it is reminding and teaching the Israelites to hold on to the promise of the coming Messiah, we read that and we get that sense of the Messiah coming as well. And there's some very interesting chapters. You read chapters 22, 23, and 24, and they are some of the most explicitly Jesus chapters. Words so incredibly aligned with the person of Jesus that I don't understand how someone can read them and not see that it's talking about Jesus. It's unbelievable. We've talked about Psalm 22 before. Psalm 23 is one of the most famous. Though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil, right? He is my shepherd. So that passage is very famous. But they all point to this coming Messiah. And we read them and we're encouraged that he came, but it also reminds us that he is coming. So that's the first book of Psalm. The second book, the second section, the second collection is Psalms 42 through 72. And this is about God before us, right? That he is doing a work, that he has gone before us, that he has made a way for us, that he has prepared us to follow him. And it correlates with Exodus. And so the second collection encourages readers to prepare your hearts. Prepare our hearts for the future king and the hope that he will bring for all believers. So when you read through these chapters, you get this sense that we're not just supposed to be idle. We're not supposed to be complacent. We're supposed to be active. We're supposed to be in a spirit and attitude of worship and reverence and obedience and trust and looking to what is to come. We are aligning our heart to God often. Now, you get that sense of pain and praise and the many voices of David, which is a lot of the first collection, and where one chapter it's just all you've rescued me from my enemies, and then the next chapter it's what's going on, I can't breathe, you know, what is happening, the world is crushing, my enemies have come against me, and that roller coaster ride when you read these things is to really remind us that it's not always roses and rainbows and perfect scenarios, that it is challenging, it is tough, and that's why when I brought up the journal, I feel like you get this sense of what these authors are going through as they have hard times. Now they use different language and say things in a way that might be odd for us today, but you can sense that they're struggling, and they're turning to God in their struggles, and it is where God wants us, which brings us to the third book. The third book, which is Psalms 73 through 89, is God above us, which goes back to Leviticus when God taught about worship and reverence for him. And it reminds us that God is constant and consistent in his work, but it also speaks to the dangers of rebellion as well as the benefits of obedience. So we get that tension again of those that are following God and reap the rewards, even though it's challenging, and even though it's tough, even though it's not always easy, versus those that are always choosing their own way and how and the consequences that follow that, both here on earth and obviously eternally too. So the fourth book of Psalms is Psalm 90. Through 106, which talks about God around us. This correlates to Numbers, and it paints a picture of creation worshiping God. And if we're not worshiping, then creation will. How creation is designed to worship God. It reminds us that our days are numbered. There's that picture of temporal versus eternal. That God is forever. And we can rely on him, and we can trust him no matter what. But our days are numbered. God is with us, is around us to help us stay on track. And then the last book, Psalms 107, 145, God among us, relating back to Deuteronomy. And this last collection focuses on salvation and triumph, victory over evil, and the praise from God's people. And we go through and could read and cherry pick verses and cherry pick chapters, but I want us to look at the very last five. And you see that as they close, as they take all of the books and bring it all to a close in chapters 146, 147, they're putting an exclamation point on each one of those collections, each one of those sections. They're reminding us that above all else, we are to worship God. That when it's great and everything is working exactly like it's supposed to, we are to worship God. And when things stink and are falling apart and are not going the way that we think they should, that we should worship God. And my favorite part about reading the Psalms is that, you know, that creepy feeling of peering into someone's journal, right? Like, I have a private diary of these authors, and I'm able to read what they're going through, right? Now, you may write personal things, and you may have a pile of notebooks that are mostly empty that say some things that are private that you don't want anyone to read. But if you were to see that, and you saw the good times and the bad times, you saw the the struggles. What I love is that it reminds me that I'm not alone in feeling the way that I feel. That I'm not on some island with these emotions when I deal with everyday life situations. The good, the bad, the ugly. There's someone else who's gone through something similar. And he might say it a different way, but I can tell that he's having a hard time. And that encourages me because something written thousands of years ago, like it's the same. These guys are going through the same kind of things I'm going through. Like when I go back to chapter 1, let's go back real quick to chapter 1. We'll come back to the end in a second. We go back to chapter 1. And if this is, I'm going to do some real major speculation here, okay? So just follow me for just a second. But I'm having a bad day. Some guy cuts me off, right, on the interstate. And I'm keeping myself from having some choice words, and I'm struggling. Like, just things are not going the way. And I want to write. I want to put it down on paper, okay? But then I think, like, it's not gonna do me any good to lament about that, because I don't know this person, I don't know who he is. But if I just put my words on paper and say what I want to say, and I read someone a little bit like that, like I'm trying to do the right thing. Blessed is the man who walks in the counsel of the wicked or stands in the way of sinners. But not the guy who cut me off, right? You see, it's like, my delight is in the way of the Lord, but the wicked, right? And you get this real sense of honesty, of compassion, of frustration, of anger, of joy, of praise and happiness, of any emotion you can think of. Just you go down the list. As you read this, you're seeing that it's all there. It's all here. And all these different authors writing their words, we get to kind of peer into it a little bit to see that it's okay to feel that way. That it's okay to come to God with our frustration. And our anger, and our upsetness. I mean, who else can we really go to get it off our chest, to say what needs to be said? Like we said last week, He can handle it, and he wants us to come to Him because we trust Him, because we know that the hope is found only in Him. He wants us to come to Him. He wants us to bring it all. He wants us to have the clenched fist arguments. But at the end of the day, He wants us to come back, to recognize who we're talking to. So like last week, the main idea from last week was that he may not always answer, give us the answer we're looking for, but He always gives us Himself, which is what we should be longing for. And so when we read the Psalms, we see that there's this frustration and asking why, and it's like, God, but then there's always that coming back to, You are God, and You're worthy to be praised. You are the hope for all of mankind. You are the joy. It is Your grace. It is Your mercy. It is Your forgiveness. It is Your faithfulness. And that is where we always come back to. Chuck Swindoll, he said that the Psalms illuminates the greatness of God and affirms His faithfulness to us in times of trouble. And this idea of putting out there what you're going through, of sharing that, right? Paul calls it bearing one another's burdens. rejoicing with those who rejoice, mourning with those who mourn. It's one of the reasons why we talk about and we emphasize small groups so much. And not just small groups, any kind of group. Any way that you can get plugged in and get connected. Because if you can be around people and you get to a point to where you may be sharing something that you were holding close to your chest, you might be sitting next to someone who goes, "You're going through that too? You're having that same kind. I'm having that same kind of struggle. What are you doing about it?" Well, man, I've been spending a lot of time praying and reading. I've been talking to different people. This has been helping me, but it's still hard. Yeah. But now all of a sudden, it's somebody else that you know can pray with you, can encourage you. Someone else you can go to when it gets tough. And then the two of you together can bear one another's burdens, can help each other keep your hearts devoted to God, to keep your focus aligned, to keep the main thing the main thing. We need each other for that. We need each other to help us stay focused. We need each other to recognize that, I mean, we're not in this alone. I mean, God didn't create us to be alone. He doesn't desire for us to be alone. And in knowing and recognizing who he is and what he's done, that is the end goal in our worship for sure. But that companionship, that the sharing of what is true, the pouring out the good and the bad and the ugly, we all need more of that. The confessing of sin, which is so hard, but maybe it shouldn't be. Because just to release yourself and to say it and to find out that you are not the only one who's sinning. I can guarantee you're not. And we have this amazing book to help us see that it's always been this way. It's always been a struggle dealing with just the contaminated world. And the blessing, the ultimate joy and peace that comes from turning away from it and turning back to God and allowing him to encourage us and to help us to overcome no matter what it is. So I want to encourage you to do something. We've been reading the Bible from the beginning of the year, and we started a reading plan. People were reading, and people are still tracking. That's awesome. But we're a little more than halfway through the year, and the interesting thing about this particular app that we were using is you can kind of see where people are. You see that some people started and didn't get very far, and some people got really far, and then maybe something's happening, and it's getting harder. And so there are people who started, people who never started. But now, as we're about approaching, the start of school, it's like the reset. You've got the January reset and the August reset. I mean, it's just kind of how our life and culture works. So we're coming into this like fall reset. If there's a the next best time to have, New Year's resolutions or like fall resolutions, this is it. So there's 150 chapters in Psalms. There's 155 days left in the year, right? So if you haven't read anything, this is the perfect time to start reading something. And you know what? Psalms are really short. Most of them would take you like 30 seconds to read a chapter. You're like, "I'm going to read a chapter a day." And you start on, if you started today, we already read Psalm 1. Congratulations, all right? So you should rather read it on your own. But you can have that. You know, that's free. So you start and commit and say, "You know what? I'm going to read something from now to the end of the year. And I want to read something that's going to encourage me, something that's going to help me, something that's not going to be confusing, that's not going to mess with my mind, it's not going to be hard to read. Read the book of Psalms. And then so 150 chapters, 155 days. Well, spend 5 days on that really, really long chapter in the middle, right? Take a little more time on that one. But just, and you might read one and go, that was really short. I'm going to read another one. You might, it's okay. But I'm encouraging you and I'm challenging you that if you didn't start reading the Bible with us, that's okay. But what a great time to start reading some of the Bible now, you know, through the end of the year. Just open up the book of Psalms, start in chapter 1. And from now to the end of the year, just try to get through it. I think you can do it. If the idea of reading 150 chapters or committing to something for 150 days is too daunting, I have another challenge for you, another idea, another option. We're going to be talking about Proverbs in a couple weeks, and Proverbs is 31 chapters, right? There are 30 to 31 days in a month, right? And August 1st is Thursday, right? So you could say, okay, I'm going to read something. I'm just going to try something. And the Proverbs chapters are a little bit longer. But the Proverbs chapters are fun. And when we talk about Proverbs, we'll talk about this. Because it's a whole bunch of just little short, small statements. And what's really good about it is, like, you may read the first five and go, that's weird, I don't know, I don't understand that, whatever. And you hit one and you go, ooh, I should, like, write that down. That's what's so great about Proverbs. And then what's amazing is, like, if you did it every month, you'd come back to that same day, like the next month, and you would see something completely different that you didn't see the first time. You'd read like the first 10 and you get like, ooh, I didn't see this last time. I need to write that down. So if you wanted something a little less daunting, but still really good, you could start August 1st and do Proverbs for 30 days. Now the bigger challenge would be to do Proverbs every month. I used to do this, and in fact, part of some of my journal stuff that I found, I was writing stuff, and I've started doing it again and started writing from Proverbs this month, and so I'm actually going to post some thoughts and commentary going through Proverbs starting in August. So if you were to do that, you could do it with me. It'd be fun, but that would be August 1st, reading Proverbs, just if you want to do just 30 days of something. And just see, allow God to just speak to you through these brilliant, genius sayings, and just see what happens for 30 days, starting on Thursday. Or read Psalms from now to the end of the year. Or if you started the plan and you wanted to just catch up, that's okay too. Just catch up. Or if you're just like, I'm just tired of the Old Testament, wait until the New Testament. New Testament's in a few weeks. So you just, you can jump into the New Testament when we start that. That's totally fine. I'm just trying to get you to see that it's so important to read this. It's so important to read this that when Ezra or whoever it was that put these together said, we have to remember these songs. We have to remember these poems. We have to put them in front of us so that we are reciting them weekly, daily, that points us back to all the good things that God has done and all the struggles that we went through as a people because we didn't obey. We have to remember this stuff. We have to acknowledge who God is. We have to be a people who keep our hearts devoted to God. Is that you? I hope so. Now the band's going to come up. And sing, and they're going to get set up and ready. And while they're getting set up, we're going to read Psalm 150, right? This, it might be the best worship setup passage, but this is how it closes. The grand doxology of the whole Psalms is right here in this last chapter. To remind us what was said, to remind us what is most important, to remind us what we are supposed to do as a people of God, as believers who want to worship and follow him. Here is Psalm 150. You ready? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That's what it said. Hallelujah. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with sounding cymbals. Praise him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You know what that says? It says, you go find something that makes noise and use it to help amplify your worship. Like, we've got the lute, right? And the harp and the clanging cymbals and the pipes, all right? We're using, you know, but look, you to dance, to let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Right now, that's what we're going to do. We're going to take a moment to close out everything else. We're not going to think about lunch. We're not going to think about afternoon plans. We're going to think about this moment right now where we get the chance to say hallelujah, to praise him in his sanctuary with his people, to praise him for his greatness, for all that he's done. Right now, we're going to take advantage of this opportunity to worship God, because that's what the Psalms tell us to do. Father, as we come before you right now, as we sing these songs, as we lift up your praise, as we shout hallelujah, as we remember your greatness, even though what we're going through right now might be impossible, challenging, difficult, hard, we're going to take a moment to lay it at your feet, to remind us that you told us to bring it to you, to know that there's an entire book in the Bible devoted to people who went through harder things, who had to come to you with their frustrations and their anger and their hurt and their pain, because you promised and we sing on that promise. We praise you on that promise. And we ask you to move in this moment right now. Every heart praising you. Praising Yahweh. Hallelujah. To you, God. And we pray that in Jesus' name.